to be most productive. We need that downtime. We need recovery time. Recovery is part of peak performance.
All the good things that come out of some of the bad things that happen in our life, you don't necessarily realize in that moment.
Life is a dance between making it happen and letting it happen.
Hi everyone, and welcome to the 2024 edition of the Live, Love, Laugh lecture series. Since 2019, the Live, Love, Laugh lecture series has showcased some of the world's foremost thinkers and influencers, offering perspective on the forces shaping the global mental health narrative. In 2019, we had Pulitzer Prize winner and oncologist Dr. Siddhartha Mukherjee as our speaker. Abhinav Bindra, India's first Olympic gold medal winning shooter, was our featured guest in 2021. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, executive chairperson of Biocon, and Anant Narayanan, founder of Mensa Brands, were our esteemed speakers in 2023. This year, we're honored to have Arianna Huffington as our featured speaker. She's a trailblazing entrepreneur who transformed the media industry in the 2000s with the Huffington Post. Over the years, she has led a global movement towards well-being with Thrive Global. Her journey from overcoming personal struggles to empowering millions through her wisdom and resilience is nothing short of inspiring. Her insights into prioritizing self-care and fostering a culture of holistic well-being resonate deeply with our mission at the Live, Love, Laugh Foundation. Arianna, thank you so much for agreeing to be a part of Live, Love, Laugh's lecture series 2024. It's an absolute honor for us. Myself and all of us have been following your work at Thrive Global for many, many years now, and we've been very inspired, and we're thrilled that you've been able to make the time for us and do this with us. And I'm sure that by the end of this conversation, everyone watching this is going to take away a lot.
Well, Deepika, I'm just so full of admiration for what you are doing and for the way you have helped destigmatize mental health problems and give people permission to talk about what they are going through the way you talked about your own journey. So it's a real pleasure to be with you.
Thank you. Arianna, let's start by talking about your childhood. You were born in Athens, you grew up in Athens. Tell us a little bit about your life in Greece.
So I was brought up in a one-bedroom apartment in Athens, Greece, with my mother and my younger sister. My mother is in a way the foundation of my existence. She was absolutely incredible in that she gave me a sense of unconditional loving, but also made me feel that I could aim for the stars and that if I didn't succeed, she wouldn't love me any less. One of the things she taught me from a very early age is to take risks, not to be afraid of failing. She used to say, failure is not the opposite of success, it's a stepping stone to success. And even though we didn't have any money, she always made us feel abundant. It was really a life where I felt I could try for anything I wanted. And that's what happened one day. I saw a picture of Cambridge University in a magazine. And I brought the magazine home and I said to everybody I knew, I want to go there. And everybody said, don't be ridiculous. You can't go there. We have no money. You don't speak English. And it's hard even for English girls to get into Cambridge. And my mother said, let's see how you can get there. Let's find out how you can learn English and take your general certificates of education. She found out I could do it through the British Council and apply for a scholarship. And we did all that. And what was amazing, Deepika, is that I never felt pressured. It was an adventure. And I always felt that if I didn't get into Cambridge, there would be another adventure. So it wasn't like the end of the world.
How was the change for you? Because, you know, I moved from a city called Bangalore down south in India to Mumbai when I was about 19. What was the change like for you from Athens, you know, not coming from a lot of money, not knowing the language, moving to a really big city like London, and also a massive university like Cambridge? So what was that experience like?
You know, it was a dramatic change. I went from a loving home, a little kind of warm, caring, to a college that looked so gothic, where I lived in a tiny room, and Deepika, I had to feed shillings into the heater to keep it warm. I had to walk a mile, it seemed, to go to the bathroom in these cold corridors. So it was a very, very different existence. But what I absolutely loved was the Cambridge Union. The Cambridge Union is a debating society. And I loved seeing like people's hearts and minds being moved by words, mm-hmm. and learning to debate. And when I started speaking, I was ridiculed because I had this very heavy accent. And so it was really building grit and resilience and not like letting the naysayers get me down. And gradually, actually, standing for election for the standing committee, then secretary, then vice president, and then becoming president of the union, which was a pretty kind of big moment in my life, because a part of being president means you organize a debate around a topic you care about, and mine was the changing role of women. And the debate was televised, and an English publisher saw the debate and asked me if I would write a book on the views I expressed in the debate. And I wrote back, "I can't write." And he wrote back, "Can you have lunch?" And he took me to lunch and offered me a modest advance to be able to take a year, write the book. And so at the age of 23, I had my first book published. And amazingly, it was translated in 36 languages and wow. did really well. I studied economics. I haven't done very much with my degree. And you know, Deepika, it was kind of a hard moment. I felt like I was having a midlife crisis in my early 20s, because suddenly I was financially independent.
Yep.
I had a career I had not expected as a writer. And I was asking like the question, is that all there is? And all my life there was that spiritual sense that there is more to life than just our material success. And so that was a moment for me to go deeper.
What prompted you to then move from the UK to the US?
There is one concept I learned that still guides me, which is the concept of opportunity cost. Like that every time you decide to do something, you are foregoing doing something else. So kind of making sure this is what you really want to do. So basically I left and moved to New York because a man wouldn't marry me. And It turned out to be the best thing I did in my life. All the good things that happened after that, my children, my books, the Huffington Post, Thrive Global. I say to people, happened because of something bad. And it's also so true in our lives. Sometimes the things that go wrong open doors.
Yes.
For things that go spectacularly right. Don't you find that?
I also feel like you really need to be patient in that process. And all the good things that come out of some of the bad things that happen in our life, you don't necessarily realize in that moment. But as you, as you sort of power through and, and time goes by, and then, I think it's then when you look back at your journey or at your life and you reflect and you realize, wow, that opportunity actually forced me and pushed me towards doing something that you'd probably never thought of or imagined.
Absolutely.
Do you think the Huffington Post would have happened if you didn't do that, make that shift?
Oh, absolutely not.
Yeah.
Absolutely not. And even marrying a man called Michael Huffington.
Correct.
Because my maiden name is Arianna Stasinopoulos, and Stasinopoulos Post does not sound as good, right? So I love what you said, that so often, especially if you're a type A personality and like to make things happen, you think you make everything happen.
Correct.
But you don't. When I look back at my life, so many good things that happened, I didn't make happen. They came to me and I was open to them. I mean, like being asked to write a book, it wasn't my idea.
Correct.
Sure, I ended up doing the work and writing it, but it was an opportunity that came to me. So I have a little saying on my desk that's life is a dance between making it happen and letting it happen. And that's also what you said, Deepika, about patience.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to be patient for things to marinate and come to fruition.
So what are some of the challenges that you probably experienced, as you set up or at the, beginning of your Huffington Post journey?
So a lot of challenges, and I'm so happy you're asking me about that, because so often when people succeed, we don't talk as much about the failures and the challenges. I remember the first day we launched the Huffington Post. I remember one of the reviews, Deepika, I've learned it by heart. It said, the Huffington Post is an unsurvivable failure. It is the movie equivalent of Gili, Ishtar, and Heaven's Gate all rolled into one. Now, in case you're not clear, these were all major flops. And of course, that was pretty awful on day one. A year later, the same writer sent me an email and said, I was wrong. The Huffington Post has become an indispensable part of the internet and I'd like to write for you.
Mm.
And I said, great, I would love you to write for us. Because one of the things I learned from my mother early on is that holding grudges and resentments is the worst thing you can do.
Absolutely.
So I really like to move through life as much as possible, releasing any grudges and forgiving myself, first of all. I think sometimes the hardest thing is for us to forgive ourselves for mistakes we make.
Yep.
And then forgiving others so that we don't carry that burden with us.
No, that's so well said. I think very often we hold on to things, and it's absolutely, I think, normal and human to feel pain, to feel anger, to feel some of these extreme emotions or emotions that, and learning from that experience, or learning from, from that, and sort of moving on. I had a similar experience when, you know, my debut movie released, Om Shanti Om, in 2007. And I remember exactly like your journey. I remember one bad, of course, there were quite a few bad reviews, but I specifically remember this one bad review. And I think it's that sort of pushed me and prompted me to work on myself. And, you know, it spoke about my accent, it spoke about my diction, it spoke about my talent and my capabilities. And I think negativity sometimes is a good thing. It's what you make of it, right? And I think that both of us in our situation, if I may say so myself, could have been, you know, upset or... And not to say that it wouldn't have upset you, but I think the larger picture is, what do you do with that criticism? How do you use it positively? How do you work on yourself? And also realize that it's not going to happen overnight. You're going to have to put in the work and be patient and then eventually come out on the other side. And, you know, I think, like you said, the fact that that journalist eventually started, you know,
writing for you,
is probably one of your biggest victories, you know, and testament to your resilience.
Well, I love what you said, because so often people are devastated by naysayers, by bad reviews, and it stops them.
Mm.
Or you can take it in. If there is anything to learn from it, you learn from it. You know, Deepika, I found the hardest thing in my life was my own self-criticism. You know, that voice in my head that puts me down and focuses on my mistakes, real or imaginary. In fact, I call that voice the obnoxious roommate living in my head. And I've learned through many years to actually not be so influenced by that voice. In fact, one of the micro steps we have at Thrive, micro steps are small, little, incremental steps that lead to healthier habits. One of them is to schedule worry time. So when that voice says, for example, oh, the way you answered that question that Deepika had wasn't good, people wouldn't understand what you said or something, I can say to that voice, you know, we have worry time scheduled on Thursday at 2 p.m. So let's handle it then. And you know, it's amazing how it works.
Yeah.
And it's based actually on the neuroscience that we don't have to address something right now so that we can move back in the present and not let our mind move into rumination, mm-hmm. which also is one of the mental health problems.
Yes.
You know, if we ruminate and focus on the negative,
right,
it's so much easier to get depressed or anxious.
I remember very clearly when we, you know, when we met and you spoke about that moment when, you know, you were overworked and there was a day when you collapsed.
Yes.
What was that moment?
So it was 2 years into building the Huffington Post. I was the divorced mother of two little girls. And I had bought Deepika into the collective delusion that in order to succeed, to be a super founder and a super mom, I didn't have the luxury to take care of myself. So literally, I didn't sleep a lot. I didn't exercise. I ate whatever was there. You know, I literally put myself last. And one morning, I was at my desk and I felt cold and I got up to go get a sweater and I collapsed and I hit my head on my desk, broke my cheekbone. And that was the beginning of a journey, first of all, to find out what was wrong with me.
Right.
You know, when you suddenly collapse, they put you through echocardiograms and MRIs to see, did I have a brain tumor? Did I have a heart defect? What happened? And I was diagnosed with burnout. And at the time, burnout was not a term that was much in use. And it was really something that completely changed my life, because I learned through all my studies at the time that it wasn't just my problem, that it was a global epidemic, that people all around the world were suffering from burnout.
Yeah.
And I wanted to understand, Deepika, why? Why were so many people believing that that was the way to be most productive?
Yeah.
And, you know, it goes back to the first industrial revolution, when we started revering machines, and after machines, software. And the goal with machines and software is to minimize downtime.
Right.
But the human operating system is different. Downtime is a feature, not a bug. So we have to learn that, in fact, to be most productive,
you need downtime.
We need that downtime. We need recovery time.
Absolutely.
And we see that with athletes. I mean, you started life as an athlete.
Absolutely.
You know that recovery is part of peak performance.
Yep. You feel like for someone who actually makes time for themselves or takes a weekend off is someone who's not driven, right?
Yes.
Which I find so bizarre. You know, I think when people have boundaries, when they have, when they have a certain structure, and of course everyone's output level is different, right? And, you know, maybe 4 hours for you is too many hours for me, and maybe 8 hours for someone else is, you know. So I think, of course, it, you know, it varies from individual to individual. But I think this notion, and I think things have started to change now to some extent.
Yes.
Post-COVID, and, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's still this sort of, if someone, you know, needs downtime or time for themselves, or, you know, takes a weekend off, it's like, this person is not motivated, not driven. Okay, now let's look for someone who's willing to burn the midnight oil, and that person's great because they're like so hardworking and so committed and so dedicated. Whereas what you said is absolutely right. And I think for me, at least, it comes from being an athlete that you need your rest, you need your recovery. You, in fact, need that to be able to perform better.
Exactly.
And work sharper, and, you know, all of those things.
We learn so much from athletes.
Yeah.
And again, you know, we have a lot of athletes who invested in Thrive and are good friends, and they talk often about how it's not just your physical performance. I mean, I remember talking to Andre Iguodala, who said it's also when I'm sleep deprived or have eaten junk and go to play, if I make a mistake, and you always make mistakes in the course of a game, I can't let it go.
Mm.
So I carry it with me to the next moment.
Correct.
And that makes you much less effective. It becomes like a vicious cycle. So both physically and mentally, you are not at your best.
Absolutely.
And I think that's what we are learning now, Deepika. And in your work with mental health, which is so important, we see that these five key behaviors that we'll talk about more when we talk about Thrive, but these five key behaviors of sleep, food, mm-hmm. movement, stress management, and connection are central, not just for our physical health, but for our mental health.
Absolutely.
I mean, I know when I'm sleep deprived, I'm much more emotionally reactive.
Yes.
Like a challenge, a problem is going to affect me much more.
Yeah.
And that, of course, affects your mental health.
Absolutely. And also, yeah, I think just that, you know, when you're sleep deprived or when you're burnt out, just the decisions that you make. And I think sometimes I can actually feel it. Like, I know on particular days when I'm feeling stressed or I'm feeling, you know, burnt out because I haven't slept enough or, you know, practiced my self-care rituals or, you know, I can tell that my decision-making is getting affected to some extent.
Yes.
How did your burnout experience prompt you to set up Thrive Global?
Okay, well, it took a while. The first thing I did was I started covering these issues at the Huffington Post. So we would cover sleep and stress and connection, all these issues. And I wrote two books on the subject, Thrive and the Sleep Revolution. Thrive was a more autobiographical book about how, in order to live life so that we thrive and don't just survive, we need to go beyond defining success as money and status slash power and include what I call the third metric of success, which is our health and well-being, our capacity to connect with our wisdom and our intuition, our capacity to be connected to the wonder and mystery of life, mm-hmm. and to give back. So that's what a complete good life. And that's why one of the problems with modern life is that we feel we are going to be more productive if we're multitasking. And multitasking is the opposite of mindful.
Yes.
Instead of being really present.
Correct.
We think, oh, I'm going to do this and this at the same time, and we do neither really well, and we lose that mindfulness. But to go back to your question, so how did I go from collapsing to Thrive Global? So after I wrote these two books, and I was on book tour for my book on sleep, The Sleep Revolution, I realized that it wasn't enough to raise awareness. I wanted to help people change behaviors. And, you know, you can continue raising awareness through books and through a media company like the Huffington Post, but I wanted to create a behavior change technology company to help people adopt these healthier habits. And to do that, I had to leave the Huffington Post, which Deepika never thought I would leave. It was like a third child, and launch a new company and start again.
All over again, yes.
Yes, and it was a very tough decision. I remember talking to Sheryl Sandberg and saying to her, you know, I made a list of pros and cons, and she said to me, tear up your list. Take a deep breath and jump.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to figure it out intellectually. You know, your heart tells you you want to do that.
Absolutely.
And so I made that jump, and it was amazing. It was 2016, so it's now 7 years. And it's been an incredible journey.
Everything that you've said to me today is something that I resonate with. It's not about making a huge drastic change overnight. It's about starting small, you know, and bringing about those little changes from maybe a different lifestyle that one has had to now making those small little changes so that you can be consistent with it. And it becomes a part of your lifestyle. Because a lot of times, you know, I think whether it's nutrition or exercise, we take on something that is so not sustainable. There's a trigger, and then you do something that prompts you to do something about it, but you do it for 2 months and 3 months, and then you slip back into an old habit. But I think to be able to bring about small changes and be able to be consistent with it so yes. that it eventually becomes a part of you and your lifestyle are really
that
some of the things.
Key. That is absolutely the key. And you know, we have an amazing board of scientific advisors working on behavior change. And Deepika, it's so important for everyone to know that small, tiny daily changes lead to sustainable, healthy habits.
Absolutely.
Because most people now think, I'm going to make New Year resolutions, I'm going to give up all sugar.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to go to the gym for an hour every day. And people may do it for 2 to 3 weeks and then they abandon it.
Correct.
And they feel defeated. So it's harder to get back on the horse and do what's best for your health. So that's why we call these micro steps, and we have thousands at Thrive, too small to fail. Really tiny, that become healthier habits. And given that 45% of our life is based on our habits.
Yes.
When something becomes a habit, it becomes more automatic.
Correct.
And another thing that I love about our journeys is that both you and I, when we learn something for ourselves, we want to spread the word out. It's not enough to just change our lives.
Yeah.
We want to like go out there and shout it from the rooftop and help others. And I love that about you, because you could have learned things for yourself on your mental health journey, but no, you wanted to go ahead and spread the word and help others who were reluctant to speak about their journey, but who admired you, to learn from your own experience. I love that. I think that's what motivates us, and definitely that's what made me want to start Thrive, the company, and constantly keep improving what we are bringing to the world.
Yes.
And, you know, Deepika, one of my favorite things about changing habits is what is known as habit stacking. Like, if there is something you do every day, as we all like brush our teeth, you can stack another habit on it, remembering three things you are grateful for. Because gratitude is absolutely magical.
Yes.
Gratitude and anxiety cannot coexist.
Yes.
So if you're brushing your teeth, instead of doing it mechanically, I remember, three things I'm grateful for this day. And they don't have to be big things. It can be my iced coffee. It can be, you know, a gardenia I saw this morning in my garden. You know, little things that connect us with what we love.
So what are some of those, what are those little changes that you've brought about?
Yeah, so my absolute favorite micro step was to pick a time at the end of the day that I consider the end of my working day. Because honestly, Deepika, I'm sure you and I and most people watching don't have a real end to their working day, right? We could stay up all night texting and handling things. We have to declare an end. And I declare an end by turning off my phone and charging it outside my bedroom. Now, that may seem incredibly hard for people. Don't worry about it. Start with one night a week. And you know, we have a mental health crisis among young people.
Yes.
And part of the reason is because they sleep with their phones. And instead of sleeping, they TikTok or Snap or whatever. So they wake up exhausted.
Correct.
And therefore more likely to become anxious or depressed.
I'm sure people are wondering, and I'm going to ask you this question. So say you have this switch off time, and then say maybe it's 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. or something. And then you have this thought, right? And this urge to sort of, this urge to message that person or send that email out because you feel like you're going to forget that task.
Forget it. Very easy. You have a little notepad.
There you go. Yeah.
With a pen by your bed, and you write down, and then in the morning you act on it. But the another micro step around sleep, Deepika, is that I do every night, I have a hot bath or a hot shower before I get into bed. It's not for cleanliness. Mm. It's to begin to slow down my brain.
Correct.
Because what happens often is we are physically exhausted, so we fall asleep, but then our brain hasn't really slowed down, so it wakes us up in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
And it's the most unproductive time when the brain goes over what we have to do, a project, the problem. And that's why preparation for sleep.
Correct.
And having, I only read things in bed that have nothing to do with work and physical books, not screens.
Yes.
So you basically move into another mode. If you think of it, our daily lives are about control, like making things happen. Life, when we sleep, is about surrender. And so we need to move to a different modality.
Correct. So you put your phone away, it's in another, and when you said it sleeps in its bed, it has its own bed for everyone that's watching. It
yes.
has its own bed that's not in your bedroom, that's outside.
Outside.
And a warm shower, a hot shower. For reading, yes, a lot of people read, you know, off digital screens, but I think going back to the traditional sort of reading,
yes.
you know, a good old book.
I love, you know, cuddling up with a real book. I love that.
Dimming the lights maybe, just so that your brain and body starts adapting
yes.
to, you know, a different, like you said, your brain starts telling you that it's now time to wind down.
Well, you know, I mean, try and make your bedroom as dark as possible when you sleep. When I travel, Deepika, you know, there are always these blinking lights in hotels. You know, the TV has a blinking light, the smoke alarm has a blinking light. I travel with a black electric tape and I go around and cover all these blinking lights.
Yeah.
And also, if you wake up in the middle of the night, there is something I love called box breathing.
Yes.
And Navy SEALs in the States, you know, practice it to reduce stress. And, you know, I feel strange talking about breathing to you because, you know, India, of course, is the birthplace
of breathwork,
of breathing and the power of breathing and the superpower of breathing. But you have exported it around the world, and box breathing is basically inhale to the count of four, pausing to the count of four, exhaling to the count of four, pausing to the count of four. And it's kind of amazing how it moves us from the sympathetic to the parasympathetic nervous system.
Correct. How do you feel like you're most productive when you, at the end of the day, when you, you know, you're like, Arianna, this was a lovely, productive day. So how do you, you know, what are the things that you do to ensure that you feel like you've had a productive day?
Well, for me, Deepika, the first thing is to be clear about my priorities. Like, what do I want to prioritize? Because it's so easy to start doing things that are not really important but are right in front of you.
Mm.
Or to respond to incoming emails, texts, WhatsApps. So I find I have a productive day when I have clarity about my intention for the day. What is it that I want to achieve that day?
For that day, correct.
And then be able to set boundaries and say no to things that would get in the way.
Yep.
And because if you say yes to everything, you are going to miss out on what's the most important. And the most important may be going to your child's dance recital. You know, it doesn't all have to be around work.
True.
It can be, you know, anything that day has to be completed.
True.
But also another thing is that I have used habit stacking to integrate exercise in my everyday by never ever watching a show or a movie except on my treadmill or on my bike.
Really?
I've trained myself, yes, to actually only watch something I want to watch when I'm exercising. And it's kind of amazing. Like, if I'm watching a series, I may end up being on my treadmill for 2.5 hours because I want to see the next episode and the next episode. So instead of binge watching on my couch, I binge watch on my treadmill.
But then you're not practicing mindfulness.
Oh, no. Mindfulness for me is when you are doing two mental things at once.
Right, okay. Understood.
Things that require, you know, but the one here is physical and the other is mental.
Okay.
The last time my mother was angry at me, for example, when she saw me talking to one of my children and opening my mail at the same time.
Understood. Okay, that makes sense. Arianna, one of the initiatives at Thrive Global is this thing called Reset. Tell us about what Reset is.
So, we talked about stress management as one of the five behaviors we need to manage. And stress is unavoidable. Like, there is no life that doesn't have stress. But cumulative stress is avoidable. So we've created this 60-second resets based on the neuroscience that it takes 60 to 90 seconds to move us from the sympathetic to the parasympathetic nervous system.
Okay.
I'd love to show mine, and you'll see that at the moment when you get some bad news or you're feeling exhausted and stressed out, you can play this, and in 60 seconds, you can be reminded of what you love about your life.
Mm.
So you'll see in mine pictures of my children, quotes I love, and also music.
Okay. We'd love to see your reset video, if that's possible.
Wonderful. Yes, let's play it.
How lovely. I think that's so lovely because I think whenever you feel either stressed or burnt out or just not grounded, I feel like something
yes.
like this with just lovely, you know, it's the music and visuals that obviously you've taken time to put together, visuals that mean something to you. And when the world around you feels like it's in a flux, I think something like this just, and I love the fact that it says inhale and exhale. It just reminds you the
yes.
basics of life, which is just to breathe in and out. And I think it helps you feel grounded again, centered and rooted.
Exactly. Grounded and rooted. I love that. And what I love is that it takes 60 seconds.
It takes only 60 seconds, yeah.
Because often you can tell people to start meditating and they can say, I don't have 20 minutes.
Correct.
But nobody's going to tell you, I don't have 60 seconds to breathe consciously or to play a reset or to set my intention for the day. Something that is mindful but doesn't take a lot of time, so that you build that muscle.
Finally, I just wanted to wrap by asking you, you know, your message to all the young people out there who, you know, are now navigating this sort of fast-paced life. What is your message to all of them?
So, Deepika, my message is to remember that we all have in us a place of wisdom, peace, strength, resilience. We all have it. It's like our birthright, that divine spark, if you want. Most of the time, we are disconnected from it. But we have the ability to reconnect quickly with it again and again and again during the day.
Yeah.
And when we connect with that, we really get that strength to go through life, no matter what life brings our way, and also to find joy and love in what we're doing. So I feel this is an amazing moment that we are having this conversation, and that we can use our own experience, yours, mine, the lessons we learned,
yes,
to help people know that just by integrating these small steps every day, we can dramatically affect both our physical and our mental health.
Love.
So my final message is, you know how we always say onward, upward?
Yeah.
Well, I like to say onward, upward, and inward. Because when we go inward, the onward and upward journey becomes both easier and more effective. Because ultimately, the most important frontier for me is not outer space, it's inner space.
That's so well said. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deepika. Thank you for this wonderful conversation, and thank you for everything you are doing in the world.
No, not at all. Thank you so much. And as I'd expected, I've taken away so much from you, as I have always been a huge admirer of all of the work that you've done. Thank you for your time. There's so much to take away from this conversation. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Deepika.
Thank you.